Hi, how are you guys doing today? My name is Rich from Rich TV Live. I'm here with a very special guest. It is Jamie, who is the Vice President of Corporate Development for Indiva. How are you doing today, Jamie?
I'm doing very well. It's great to be here at the Lyft Conference in Vancouver.
It is, and thank you for flying all the way from Toronto to come join us. And I know you guys were here last year. What do you think of the event so far?
Haven't really had a chance to walk around too much, but thus far I saw some of the setup yesterday. Seems like all the major players are here. There's a lot of excitement around edibles, and I mean, that's part of what we're excited about as well. But it looks like a very well attended event, which is really good to see that this is still humming and the industry still has a lot of buzz.
Yeah, I know, it's funny because I was walking around and I was telling everybody when I first got here, I was making videos and I was live streaming on our channel. I was like, cannabis is not dead.
Exactly.
Cannabis is not dead. And everyone's looking at me. They're like, it's not dead. It's not dead. I'm like, no, it's not dead. We're in Vancouver. This is the heart of cannabis, right?
It's like Elton John. I'm still standing, you know?
Yeah, I mean, obviously the stock market for cannabis has had a massive reset, right? Mm. Indiva, like everybody, is not where you guys want to be yet as far as the stock market.
Right.
Tell us about where you guys are at and where you guys are going.
Yeah, I mean, the goal for, I think, 2020 is companies were appraised in the past on, you know, how many patients you had acquired, how many registered patients, how many active registered, then it was square footage, and we've gone through all different types of metrics and ramifications, and it was revenue, and I think guys are really waiting for that wonderful term, cash flow or free cash flow. I mean, yes. That's what we're waiting for. Guys are now pulling back on CapEx, on new expansions. Thankfully, we never fell into that trap. I mean, it doesn't mean we don't have some pain right now anyways, but we never fell into the trap of we need a 4 million square foot greenhouse. We always expected the greenhouses were going to get built, farmers were going to farm, and we were always focused on value-added products. So that is our 2020 story. We hope we're imminently away from getting our extract license, which will allow us to get Bang Chocolate into the marketplace. We have a brand we want to launch with a group called Dicar on the chocolate side as well. We already have pre-rolls in the market. We have about a 10% market share in Ontario pre-rolls.
Wow.
And we're going to start to expand that. We actually have a little excess capacity that we've since signed a deal with Supreme. So Supreme, we're now making their pre-roll Sugar Leaf by 7AC. That's
okay. My
little plug for the Supreme guys at 7Acres. And we actually have those products in two or three provinces right now, working with them hand in hand. So really 2020 is get products that customers enjoy out to the market and start to really pull in those cash flows, keep things tight on a home front in terms of our own spending, our own capital spend, and really start, hopefully, you know, second half of the year, show profitability, and more than profitability, show actual cash flow, which is basically profitability minus CapEx, right?
Oh, I think that's great, because we're at a point now where it's all about cash flow.
It is.
Yeah, it's all about profitability, and there's very few that are actually profitable yet.
Yeah.
I think maybe like 10 out of like 440 companies.
Yeah,
and I mean, it's not really even profit. It's adjusted operating income they're using. So it's not real cash flow positive yet, but we're still in such a new industry.
Correct.
You know, I use the example of Gary Vaynerchuk. You know Gary V?
No.
Big social media guy.
Yeah.
Huge cannabis enthusiast. He believes that the cannabis sector is going to be bigger than the tech sector, but he's saying that he was one of the biggest investors and did really well in the tech sector, and he said that we're going through what is a bubble, and it's burst, and coming through this, we are going to find the winners. But he believes that the winners haven't even been identified yet.
No, it's true.
That we may not even be in the first inning yet, and we're still 5 or 10 years away from really seeing the growth that is going to come. And you're going to see some fail, and you're going to see some succeed, and the biggest successors may not even been identified yet. What do you think about that belief system?
Yeah, I mean, we don't know who the strong brands are. There is no Coke. As much as we want to identify who's got the market cap and who has financial backing, whether it's Tweed or Cronos or, you know, Afri Aurora, I don't think consumers have the brand recognition just yet to identify what's Coke, what's Pepsi, you know, pick your, you know, top shelf brands, and we'll figure it out. I mean, all you can do right now within the rules in Canada is get out strong brands people enjoy, or strong products they enjoy, and then the recognition and word of mouth builds because of all the wonderful limitations around advertising. And we're even only hitting the cusp of cannabis 2.0, which I think broadens it out to the non-smokers.
Absolutely.
We're finally hitting that second stage, which is a big piece of the market south of the border. I mean, California, you add up edibles and vaping. Well, we can talk about vaping on a different context, but that's 50% of the market. There are flower smokers. They'll pick their favorites. It might not necessarily be the Tweeds of the world, you know, where they find that one strain they fall in love with. So there's a big flush out that will happen. It's really hard to pick winners. It's hard to figure out where that next niche product that really, you know, like a LaCroix water, you know, comes out of nowhere and becomes a dominant player in a niche market, or alkaline water or something like that. So we'll figure it out. I mean, we think we have some very strong brands, one of which we've brought up from California called Bang Chocolate, that has very, very strong recognition south of the border. We're hoping that recognition and the idea that it's the same in every market they move into, so they're going to be in Illinois, they're going to be in Florida, they're already in California, Nevada, so it's the exact same chocolate, the exact same flavor, will be, you know, kind of the Big Mac, you know, where everywhere you go, the Big Mac tastes the same. I mean, that's the essence of a brand, no variability. So that's what we're bringing to the Canadian marketplace, hopefully within the next, as short as 2 weeks, hopefully not much longer. The Bang Chocolate will start hitting the shelves. We have some purchase orders across the country we'd love to execute on the moment we get our license.
Great.
But Bang is a strong brand, and that's what we decided, is bring a brand up that's already, you know, well-followed, well-loved, and bring it to the Canadian marketplace and let Canadians enjoy something that already has a strong following. Will it be a winner? We hope it will. You know, it doesn't mean other chocolates won't emerge, but... That has been our strategy, is try to bring strong brands north.
I think that's the key. Now, how do you guys operate in this climate where Health Canada won't allow you to do more than 10 milligram packaging? Meanwhile, in the U.S., they got packages like under 1,000 milligrams, I'm hearing. I'm like, 1,000 milligrams, I can't even imagine that. But they literally have 100 to 1,000 milligram packaging. In Canada, it's 10 milligrams. How do you guys deal with this environment where Health Canada is really not allowing you to advertise? They're not like, you got to do more of this, right? This is really, I think, was how you get out there, right?
I think getting products on the shelves early, which is what we're trying to do, letting people try them, tell their friends. We think we're going to come in at a pretty aggressive price point as well to at least get rid of that original barrier to a customer picking your product. I think at the 10 milligram level, being aggressive on pricing to the upside is a little bit dangerous. You want to sell a drink for $12 with 10 milligrams, for some people it won't do much, and they just spent $12.
Exactly.
So we actually are coming in, I won't give the exact pricing, it will be available pretty soon, but we're gonna come in with some pretty aggressive pricing, and our actual unit size is pretty small. We're not gonna sell you a giant chocolate bar with 10 milligrams, that's, you know, 60 grams of chocolate, and then one out of five people needs to eat four of them.
Yeah.
That's not what we want to do.
It doesn't make sense.
You'll have, you know, you'll be high, but you'll be a little bit overweight, and that's not what we want. And you'll be a little full. So we actually have reduced our unit size to a 10-gram piece of chocolate with 10 milligrams, which is, it's breakable into four, it's shareable, 2.5 milligrams each to let people get a quick, you know, a slow start. That's what we've decided is our unit size.
I think it's not that big. I saw a chocolate
from you guys. Is this it? This is it. This is it.
So it's not going to look like this. Obviously, there's no yellow warning symbols, but that is essentially the size.
I'm going to open it.
That's the fun part. Yeah, you might need.
Is it difficult to open it?
It's difficult.
It's like child safety, eh? Child proof?
Well, it's,
I need scissors.
Very well sealed.
There we go. We're going to get some help from our support system here.
It's a 10-gram piece, so nothing too onerous to get to 10 milligrams. It'll come in aggressive pricing, and we'll let people try it, share it, break it up. We're actually hoping people go into dispensaries and buy three or four of them and pass them off to friends. We're coming out with milk chocolate, dark chocolate to start, THC only, and then we'll start to expand. But you're right, 10 milligrams is tough. I mean, we're all on the same level playing field. So I don't have other competitors out in the marketplace launching 50 milligrams, and we launch fives and tens. Everyone's on a level playing field.
Except for the black market.
Correct. But I think some of the black, I don't think we're after the black market in a massive, massive way. I'm not going after the 300 milligram person. I can't win them over anyways.
No, it's impossible.
For me, 5 milligrams is plenty, 10 is a lot, and those are the people we're targeting. If you're a medical patient who takes 300, sadly, you're not my customer anyways.
So this is what it looks like?
It'll look like
chocolate?
That, but it'll be scored into a 4. It'll look a little different, but essentially that is the format.
This is the Bang.
Yeah. Again, they've won multiple awards at Cannabis Cups, and it's great. It has a nice snap of a properly tempered chocolate. I think you got the dark one, so a little less child-friendly because it's a dark chocolate. A little more skewing towards, you know,
it's good.
Lower sugar. I mean, if you look at the ingredients, so your first relationship with a product when you can't market is going to be, do I like the logo? Do I like the look? Do I like the price? And the secondary one is, do I like the actual ingredients on the back? And I'll read them really quickly. Cocoa butter, cocoa solid, sugar, vanilla, soy. Done. There's five.
Like, all healthy products.
Well, nothing too crazy. And of course, in the real one, it'll say cannabis at the end. But I mean, there's nothing in there.
So how many milligrams are in this? 10?
This is zero.
Oh, this is zero.
Medicated.
So there's no medical.
We don't have our license yet. This is just some samplers we brought into the marketplace.
Okay.
just to get let people get used to the flavor.
Do you? So you said you don't have your license yet. Do you have a timeline on when you might be getting your license?
Yeah, we hopefully, let's say optimistically, let's hope in the next couple of weeks. Pessimistically, it's Health Canada dependent. Everything's Health Canada dependent. But
it's always a couple weeks.
I know. It's we submitted it quite a few many months ago, and we've been waiting patiently. If we get it this month, we'll be ecstatic. We'll get products out to market. We have an inventory of products ready to roll instantly, and we'll have these things on the shelves as soon as possible for in multiple provinces.
Okay, great.
So, and we're getting there.
For an investor that's watching, we've got investors watching in 60 countries worldwide. Mm-hmm. They're taking a major interest in cannabis stocks. There's so many global cannabis enthusiasts that just love cannabis, and they love investing, and they love this industry, myself included.
Right.
What do you say to them that, you know, there's like 440 cannabis companies? What do you say to the people that are like, okay, I'm interested, but why you? There's 440 cannabis companies. Why would I want to invest in your company? What makes Indiva such a compelling investment opportunity?
Well, I guess the first thing I can talk about is the valuation. We're trading below book. We've raised quite a bit of money. We're trading around a $20 million valuation. We're already in market with products, so we're not sitting around, you know, selling B2B. We actually have consumer products that are selling quite well. We skipped over weed in a pouch or weed in a jar and went straight to pre-rolls for financial reasons. Part of it was competition. When we originally launched pre-rolls, there was maybe 25 pre-rolls in the Canadian marketplace, so it was not crowded at all. But if you looked over at, we'll call it, you know, 3.5 gram pouches, there was 300. So yeah, we skipped that entirely. We are not ever going to put ourselves out as, you know, the best growers in the marketplace, but we make great products. So our pre-rolls look gorgeous. They don't canoe. They're properly manufactured, which is why we've been approached by multiple groups to make pre-rolls on their behalf. So we currently have multiple pre-rolls in market.
Is that like white labeling type relationship or?
No, it's more co-packing.
Co-packing?
So, you know, there's been some critiques in the marketplace as, can you have your own brands and co-packing? And, you know, in many industries that happens. So we kind of mirrored off of that. So we have our own Indiva brands. And then, like I mentioned, we have Sugar Leaf by 7AC brands that we will be creating on their behalf to get their products into the marketplace. So we're just very good at making pre-rolls. We've started to leverage that to help some of our neighbors. We're also very well located in an area where labor is not an issue. You'd be surprised how hard it is to find labor for some of the LPs out there, and they will struggle immensely to have a facility with 200 people in areas that are outside of the, you know, your large communities. So we're in London, Ontario. We are an hour away from potentially the largest market in the world, which is Toronto right now, largest legalized recreational market, which is Toronto. So for us, shipping is quite reasonable. Our access to labor in London, Ontario is very CPG oriented. We are finding some of the best CPG people, and we're not backfilling with tobacco and alcohol so much as food and CPG. We think that was more the mirror image of what our industry needs to strive toward is efficiencies that CPGs are able to create.
Great.
So that's what we've backfilled. Valuation solid. We're launching products that we know are already well accepted, like Bang Chocolate. This is not a science project. They've won dozens of awards. They've been in California for a decade. They were started by a master chocolatier. We're just leveraging what we know people already enjoy, not trying to launch brand new products from scratch with our fingers crossed that one of our SKUs catches. This is the other. So my CEO hates science projects, and we all agreed this was the way to go. We have some other products we're going to bring in from places like Seattle, where it's going to be something called Gems, which is basically like a sweet tart, a medicated sweet tart.
Nice.
We'll have cannabis sugar, cannabis salt for those people.
Oh, wow. Cannabis sugar and cannabis salt.
Yeah, that's going to be probably a Q3, maybe.
I've never even heard of that before. That's incredible.
So it's a patented process to actually combine salt and sugar with cannabis so that it dissolves perfectly, so you can bake with it. So in places like Quebec, where they won't do edibles because that are catering to children, we can market them cannabis salt. You can sprinkle it on your French fries. We can market them
That's genius.
Cannabis sugar. You can put it in your coffee. I don't have to buy cannabis coffee. I can buy 20 different kinds of coffee and just put sugar in it, and I'm done.
I like that. That's really smart. That's really, really smart.
That is the idea, is trying to make what we call flexible edibles and get that into the marketplace. We'll see if it catches on as much as we think it will. But again, not recreating the wheel. We're finding products already accepted in other states and other jurisdictions and bringing them to Canadians.
Well, you know what? I'm really, really excited to see you guys grow. Thank you for your time today.
Thank you.
Guys, this is Jamie, the Vice President of Corporate
Development yes.
for Indiva. Thank you for your time today. Have a great day.
Thank you.
I wish you the best of luck.
Thank you so much. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you guys for watching.